reporting on the games you love by people who love to game. The MMO Reporter Network.
You're logging into your favorite game, grinding out some gear. A couple of points added to your stats, and you have a virtual beer. Max level is pretty cool, but I'll remind you here, my friend. These games are not about the goal, it's about the journey and not the end.
You're listening to MMO Reporter, brought to you by Audible.com. Get a free audiobook download at audibletrial.com/MMOReporter. And by Doghouse Systems. Choose your weapon with Doghouse Systems.
Don't forget about your alts you need to cherish. Each and every little character you've got, no matter what level they're at. Don't forget about your...
Hello everyone and welcome to another episode of MMO Reporter. This is episode 223. I'm Chris and I'm joined by the Pantless Wonder himself. Hello, Leonor.
Yo, what's up?
I thought I'd throw you off guard by going pantless
you
again.
You did.
Yeah.
You heard that silence in there.
Just that little bit. I'm like, yes, mission accomplished. I should be on an aircraft carrier and a big mission accomplished banner be behind me. And yeah, okay, moving on. Hi, Bill.
That's terrible.
Okay. You know, this if there's ever a time where being pantless is okay, today was that day. It's still hot.
Oh, isn't it? It's like crazy hot here, and it's hazy. There's what, nearly 200 forest fires burning in our wonderful province?
Last count I heard was 180, and they were expecting 30 new fires a day for the rest of the summer.
Yeah. So, anyways, welcome to hazy British Columbia.
So for all those listeners that actually told us to go to hell... Done.
and hazy in a completely different way from the Netherlands, we have Mr. Harry Hall. Hello, Harry.
I'm looking at a mild fog dressing in from the east right now, and we're looking at a high 20s in the afternoon. Good morning, good afternoon. This is Harry with the weather from the Netherlands.
I didn't think the haze was from the weather. Anyways.
Don't get that.
Never mind. I'm moving along because you totally get it and you're just playing me. You're playing me,
man. That was the joke. Damn it.
All right. We got to talk games because we have actually got a jam-packed show today. We were talking about stories. We have more stories than we can talk about in the show. So we're going to get going because we do have a few quick mentions at the end. Leonor, what have you been playing in your ever-so-busy schedule?
I have been playing The Secret World. The festival events, the anniversary event has been going on. And that was double AP and double SP for your skills and abilities. And I'm down to about 12 skills now that I need to complete the entire wheel.
Wow. That's a lot. Wow. That's really cool.
That's taken a long time.
Yeah.
I've also been playing a lot of Ark. I am level 25 on the PvE server right now. Well, it's a PvP PvE server, which is kind of confusing, but
okay,
whatever.
But what
I
does
guess.
That mean?
I don't know.
Oh. Have you PvP?
I don't know what that means. People can come attack you but can't build in your house, I guess.
Okay.
But I'm level 25. I got quite a bit of skills in there and been working on a huge house, so that's coming along pretty nicely. And for my Let's Plays on YouTube, I'm still playing Dead Space, War in the North, and The Witcher. The Witcher was absolutely frustrating for me to try and figure out how the game worked because it's so weird.
The combat?
Combat. You have to left-click, kind of like a Diablo style, where you click on the creature and you'll go and attack it. But it has a timing mechanic to it when you chain your hits.
It's like a combo system, right?
Yeah. So it's a little bit weird. And then a lot of the quests really don't give you a whole lot of information. So you don't know exactly where these things are. And it was like extremely frustrating.
Right.
But other than that, in War in the North, which was the Lord of the Rings game, I got into the Barrow Downs. And if anybody doesn't know, this game is based in the Peter Jackson Lord of the Rings world. And the Barrow Downs in that game are absolutely just gorgeous. Mm-hmm. It is so, so cool looking. Like, you know, this, if Peter Jackson put it in the movie, this is exactly how it would look. I mean, it's just thunderous, full of lightning and just raining, and it's just creepy everywhere. It is great. So I'm really enjoying that game.
And what are you thinking about the combat in it? Because it's an action game, right?
Yeah, it's a hack and slash type of game. It's pretty easy. There, you get a light attack and a hard attack, kind of like the old Dynasty Warriors games. And if you beat an orc down to a certain point, you can actually cut his arm off or his head or something like that. And the game's actually rated mature just for that, surprisingly enough.
Yeah, I really enjoyed my playthrough of it. I played it a few years ago.
Bill, it was a really good game.
Did you play it as well? I don't remember if we both got a copy from Warner Brothers or just me.
Yep. Yeah, I played it as well, and I don't think I played it all the way through. I remember playing it, and it was fine. And I say fine, I'm not saying it as an F word. I'm actually saying it was a decent game. I wanted to ask Leonor, because you've played Shadows of Mordor too, right?
No, I haven't played that yet.
Oh, okay. I was going to ask you to compare them side by side and see what you think. For me, I found the Shadows of Mordor game, I don't know, it just felt a little bit more fulfilling.
Maybe. Oh, totally. Absolutely. War in the North is a good game. For me at least, Shadows of Mordor is a great game.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to pick that one up one of these days.
All right, what else?
Steam would have some kind of sale or something like that.
that's everything you've been playing. What about you, Bill? What's been keeping you busy?
Well, geez, in the interest of keeping the show rolling, I predictively played almost nothing this week. I did my Guild War 2 run. We did some World versus World streaming, which I was going to say just about put me to sleep. It actually literally put me to sleep. I don't know if for any of you that was actually tuned in at the stream there, I was a yawn factory by the end of it. That was the slowest World versus World PvP I have done, I think. I don't want to say ever, because I've been in some really slow sessions, but that was...
And it didn't help that I was distracted and trying to work out the technical issues that we were having while we were playing. So I wasn't, you know, interacting with you very much. I was sort of trying to play and fix technical stuff. And it was one of those nights.
I don't think that would have saved it. It was just, it was a boring run. There was precisely two Zergs that were basically leaping to opposite ends of the map continuously. And even when they came together, it was like just the fragments of them would come together. So there would be like eight fighting five or something like that, which would normally be fun, but it has to happen more than every 20 minutes or half an hour.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Would you say that WoW is actually maybe a great idea on paper, but turns out not to be the best idea in practice? For wouldn't more focused PvP, as they're actually bringing into the game, save this kind of battle?
I think so. Like, I love the principle of it. The idea of three armies contesting a map, that's something I loved in Dark Age of Camelot, and I felt that was kind of the pioneer for that kind of PvP, and that's what really makes me want to try it. But I've only ever had really sporadic good experiences in World versus World. Most of the time, it's slow. Not as slow as what we saw last night, but it's more regularly slow than not. So I like their structured PvP system way better. And I feel like that's probably, if they're going to focus on their PvP in Guild Wars 2, not Girl Wars 2, that's totally...
Woo!
If they're going to focus on that PvP, that's the core type of PvP gameplay they need to work on. Probably that smaller team play rather than the three-headed army play.
Well, what do you think is the difference between your enjoyment of Dark Age and the WoW? Because on paper, they sound very similar. So what do you feel is the big difference?
I think it's the size of it. Dark Age of Camelot, even though at the time it seemed huge, when you get back down to it, there were very, very clear pinch points at every map. Like it was common. Like if you had no idea what to do because you couldn't track armies in Dark Age of Camelot, you knew that there were one of like three or four places you could go to where there would be action. It might be action where you're getting steamrolled by 20 of your closest enemies, but you at least knew something was going to happen. You don't fight. I think the teleportation system that you get in Guild Wars 2 kind of kills that, and it makes it too easy to avoid the armies, and it's not really any strategy in traveling the map or anything like that. Like, it's not like you can teleport anywhere on the map, but if they took those travel stones out of PvP maps entirely, I think that would probably improve it and at least make it a little bit more strategic.
Well, but then you look, and Wings of Faith is asking in the chat room too, how would we compare Guild Wars 2 PvP against Elder Scrolls? And one of my least favorite things about Elder Scrolls is the amount of running that you have to do. Those maps are bigger, they're more spread out, but they're also very much almost feels like trading keeps. And that's what Guild Wars 2 feels like, unless, you know, really the only skill that matters, it feels like, in a Zerg, is the skill of the commander, the person who's running the Zerg. Everybody else is just critical mass to throw against whatever. Yes, having the siege engines, all that sort of stuff, but, you know, anybody can do that of any skill level. So it's just really who can throw the most numbers in the best strategic way. It's not every peg, every peon doesn't matter. And Wings of Faith in the chat room calls it Run Simulator. I agree.
Yeah, and that's exactly it. The commander drives the whole thing. And for the most part, the best strategy a commander takes is very rarely a head-to-head combat in open field. The best strategy for any commander is usually to avoid the other army, build up what properties you own or what keeps you own and that kind of thing to kind of keep supply chains going and kind of play that resource management game. And then the only time you ever actually run into another Zerg is almost by accident. It's when that's the unfortunate thing. If you're doing World versus World, you're not doing a resource gathering game. You're hoping to fight someone else.
Yeah, well, that's my memories of Warhammer when I was playing it at launch after the horrendous launch period and the actual game started to function, kind of. The best realm versus realm moments were trying to take or defend a keep, and you have these actual battles between different factions, and it wasn't the running around. And at the beginning of Guild Wars 2, I had that same feeling of that people were actually trying to defend keeps. But they're not anymore. It's almost like baseball, trying to get to the bases rather than defending their base.
Now, that said, they have apparently made people. I didn't. It's not in the show notes this week, so I'll mention it here. They the community has actually data mined a new.
It is in the show notes. App. It's in the quick mentions.
Is it? Oh, is it?
Pardon me? Is.
Good. Oh, then we'll get to that later.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll save that.
Yeah.
Let's talk about it soon. Harry, what did you play?
I didn't play that much. I still slogging through Elder Scrolls Online. But I don't want to talk about that. I've been playing a little game called Barony. And you guys must be familiar with NetHack.
Yes.
No. I don't hear many sounds of recognition.
Oh, yeah.
NetHack is basically the mother of all roguelikes. It is a huge randomly generated maze. It was in ASCII characters. So it was very but very deep. And the great thing about it was its level of depth, with lots of creatures and items to identify and lots of random levels to explore. And they've a small team has created a kind of a 3D version of that, which isn't in itself unique. I mean, there are a lot of first-person dungeon crawlers. Barony is in the style of Minecraft, so it's not entirely a pretty game, I must say. Even if you like Minecraft, this is kind of blocky and bland, but it's not about that. It's this retro feel of going into a randomly generated dungeon, choosing one of six or seven classes with very different playstyles and abilities, and going at it really hardcore. If you die, you lose everything, and the maze is regenerated, so it's not even possible to do a corpse run.
Wow.
And that makes for incredibly tense gameplay. That's a lot of fun. You must learn to let go. Because if you find this uber sort of awesomeness, you know in about 10 minutes you'll die and you'll have to go at it with a stick again. That's just how the game is. But it is really cool. It has these old school traditions of having to identify your items before you can use them. For if you don't, you have the chance of putting on a cursed helmet, which not only takes points away from your defense score, but you're unable to take it off because it's cursed. It's that kind of old school hardcore dungeon crawling, and it's fun.
I remember items in games. I was always terrified of that. I'd be running around in armor that was way underleveled for me because I was terrified to put anything new on and too lazy to go get identification scrolls.
Well, the thing with the identification is you don't need scrolls, but it does take time. And I think it's a clever mechanic. Whenever you find an item, it's first unidentified, and you have to right-click on it and select appraise. And then this counter will go up from 0 to 100%, and the more difficult the item is to appraise, the slower that clock will tick up. And you'll get better at appraising, so you'll appraise stuff quicker, but it is a real-time process. Luckily, you don't have to stand still, so you can keep exploring and the appraising process will go on, but you can only appraise one item at a time. So it's just you cannot use anything that you find that looks uber unless you actually check out that it's safe to use. I think there's a lot of... And it's multiplayer. I haven't yet tried a multiplayer yet, but you can actually do a four-person run through the game, and I think that is going to be very MMO-like.
That's interesting.
Persistent characters, right? So you can actually... It's not like if you quit the game that you lose everything like in Spelunky. It's a persistent character, but death is death.
Death is persistent.
Very.
All right, what else have you been playing?
I've returned to Inaba, and Inaba is the little town in the game of Persona 4. This game, it's like my summer game or something, and it's a long game. I'm now, my counter says that I'm about 51 hours into it. And what I can gather, I'm about two-thirds, maybe three-quarters of the way through the game. And it's, I've talked about this before, it's a Japanese role-playing game set in a little Japanese town.
That's not the one where you have to rub the back of the Vita back and forth, is it?
No.
No. I finished that. But it's this is an actual real cool doing dungeons, and the great thing about this game is it is so well written. You are a teenager transferring into a high school, and you have to make new friends. And making friends in the game is an actual mechanic. And the friends that join your team, with which you do your dungeon exploring and your fighting and everything, they are also just regular teenagers in the town. And you can choose to date them, or to go to a movie together, or have something to eat. And all those activities also have little stories that unravel while you're investing time in them. And it sounds kind of weird when I describe it, but it's a Japanese high school simulator, and it is a fantasy role-playing game mushed together, and it is fantastic. It is still one of my favorite RPGs ever, so I'm happy to return to it. I can only say, if a game has a cutscene with a voice acting and just things happening without interaction for about 20 minutes at two-thirds through the game, and I'm not bored, that says something about a writer.
Wow. Yeah. At that point, you're watching a movie, not playing a game.
It feels a lot like a good way. Yeah. Well, it feels like it's kind of a Japanese Twin Peaks kind of sensibility.
Okay.
Reminds me of the 1995 buzzword, interactive cinema.
Well, cutscenes are not like cinematic with sweeping camera motions. It's all in the event engine and stuff. But it's just if you have a Vita, Persona 4 is just a must buy. It's like the game on the system.
Okay, so this is not like Wing Commander 3.
No,
Mark Hamill. This,
but it is very much in all its splendor a JRPG.
Well, I won't hold that against you.
That's good, because that would be uncomfortable. Rocket League is the final game on my list. You guys have a PlayStation 4, everybody?
I do.
No.
No.
I'm that guy.
Chris is sending me his.
Sorry. Go ahead.
That was an actual laughter of derision. You do have PlayStation Plus, right?
Yep.
Yeah, because if you don't have PlayStation Plus, then you're just losing out on great stuff. Every month you get a couple of games that are included with your paid subscription, so I'm not going to call them free. And this month, my favorite game of the bunch is Rocket League.
Oh, cool.
Have you played it?
I have not yet. Although
you should
I've heard
play it.
Things of it.
It is a. It's very simple. It is soccer, football, whatever you would like to call it.
Yeah.
In cars.
I'm gonna guess there's rockets too.
Well, not even. It's you have this nitro boost, so you can have a quick speed.
Is that the reference to rocket?
Yeah, but it's not. You are basically driving RC cars, so they look like RC cars, like very low and small and.
Yeah.
The game is, I think it's set on Mars or something because the gravity isn't really Earth normal. Yeah. But that doesn't matter. It is fantastically, it's frantic, it's fun. And the only thing you have to do is try to get the ball in the goal of the other team. And you can play in teams of 1, 2, 3, or 4 cars on your per side. And there's nothing more to it. There are no weapons. There are no upgrades. It's just car on car, hardcore ball banging action. That sounded worse than in my mind. It sounded so fantastically. But then, okay, I'll stick by it. This is my description. I'm sticking by it. Damn it.
Yeah, that's the next shirt. Who wants to buy that shirt? That would make a great coffee cup.
Yeah, right. Hardcore ball banging action. That's
car on car.
Rocket League is absolutely the best multiplayer game I've played in a long while. Shut up.
We're going to make Carrie get strange looks on the bus again.
I'm not even going to say that the 3-on-3 mode is the best, but it is.
Most multiplayer ball banking games are pretty good, so that's actually saying a lot.
Chris, what have you been playing?
Oh, man. Whew. All right. I've actually had kind of a busy week. Lots of stuff going on. I jumped into the World of Warships open beta and tried that out. And I love all of the... Love is the wrong word. I really enjoy all of the wargaming games. I find that their system of progression is really fair. I think that it works well in the spending money gets you different types of ships, planes, etc. Not necessarily pay to win. It just gives you more versatility. And they manage this arcadification of all these different types of battles, tanks, planes, ships, very, very well. They look pretty, they play pretty, and they're just really, really enjoyable. So, I can highly recommend, if the open beta is still on by the time everybody listens to this podcast, you should all jump in. I think that Arkham Knight is probably going to be my first game on PlayStation that I 100%, because I'm loving the crap out of that. And it actually plays not too bad on my Vita. As I sort of go through all the different side quests and stuff, it plays okay. It's a little hard in R2, but...
You're missing some controls on the car, right? I mean, the walking bits are okay, but...
No, you have all the controls. They're just on the back.
I hate that.
I don't enjoy it, but when I'm going around and I'm doing Riddler puzzles or I'm doing simple stuff, then yeah, the Vita's great. I have to pick which missions I can do. Fighting is fine. I have no problem. And I can even use the back left two to get all my gadgets going, no problem. But if car stuff I don't love to do on the Vita, I tend to leave that. Flying is okay. Fighting's okay. So Riddler stuff is good. Firefighter stuff is good. Overall, just a really fantastic game. I haven't finished... I did finish Arkham Asylum, but I just finished it. I didn't go back and get everything done. But I am doing everything in Arkham Knight. I cannot recommend that game enough to everyone.
There are a lot of Riddler trophies. I mean, a friend of mine said the exact same thing. And at a certain point, he said, no. No, not the Riddler trophies. Not another one.
Yeah, well, the Riddler trophies are meant to be for that type of person who is looking for that.
That's
incredibly...
crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to go for it.
Insane.
Yeah, I'm going to go for it.
OCD.
I wouldn't go that far, but I'm going to go for it. I played Skyforge today. Today was... The early access before open beta, let's just call it soft launch, thank you, of Skyforge. So I've jumped in there, leveling up my paladin. I think I'm going to end up going as a knight, but the cool thing, like Final Fantasy XIV in Skyforge, is you can have all of the different classes on the one character. You can unlock them all and then play through them all, so you don't need any alts, which is really, really cool. But I still, I there's nothing wrong with Skyforge. There's just nothing that drives me like, ooh, I gotta play more. Kind of, I think, how you're going with ESO, Harry, which we'll talk about more in a bit. But
sure.
I'm playing through it. It's not bad. I'm not enjoying the experience, but I don't log off thinking, ooh, I can't wait till I get back on. Can't wait. Right?
Right.
The world is kind of this techno-fantasy thing, which is really kind of an interesting thing. What I am actually dying for and wishing that we would finish the podcast for is to jump back into Guild of Dungeoneering. This is a game that I didn't know anything else about until... I didn't know anything about until Ben and Celeste did an interview at PAX South. And that's what I love about our PAX coverage. We can get all these different little bits of the convention that we wouldn't think of. So what it is I really find a hard time describing it. It's a dungeon crawler, kind of. You build up your guild, you build rooms where you can get certain types of heroes. Then you go in and you go and explore and you go into a dungeon. But you get different types of cards. And it's all the style is like hand-drawn, like kids did it with crayons. And you can place either room cards, which have different shapes and have connect together like a puzzle to build the dungeon. You can place monster cards, which you'll fight and you'll get XP. Or you can place treasure cards. But then the combat, when you do fight something, it's card-based as well. You have different attacks, different attack types, defense types, different variables and all that sort of stuff. It's very puzzle-ish in the fighting. You can't just click on your biggest attack all the time. You have to think, okay, how am I going to counter this one? So it's very much like a card game in that. And the music is probably my favorite music that I have heard in any game. And I am talking even WildStar, which WildStar is my favorite soundtrack of all time. Rift, I think, is second. And this music is amazing. Just the hooks in the melodies are... Anyways, sorry. Somebody was going to ask a question. I totally steamrolled over it. Go ahead. Somebody took a breath in like a question like... No? 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 Oh.
I was
breathing a while ago.
Oh, okay. I cannot recommend this game enough. It's in preview right now. I've got a preview copy. There's no NDA, so I'm allowed to talk about it, though. It goes live on Tuesday, the 14th. So everyone go out, spend some money, get that game, because you are going to enjoy it. I will have, by the time this podcast goes live, I will have a video out about the game so that you can get a good visual look at it and some more thoughts on my end. But it's going to be pretty positive, I'll tell you that right now. Yeah. Anyways, since yes. I hate to talk over all of you as you're discussing my what I've played this game, but we also, Bill and I, with our friend Matt, have launched Crowfall Reporter. That episode will be out as well by the time you download this podcast, but we've got a new game coming up called Crowfall. It's PvP-based, made by the guys who made Ultima Online and Shadowbane, very much in Shadowbane style, but they're trying to fix it. Go listen to Crowfall Reporter if you want to find out more about it.
I don't mind talking over your section, but I thought it was impolite, so I thought I'd just listen to what you have to say. But I can add to the previous item. For example, Ben Affleck is going to both write and direct and star in the new Batman movie.
Seriously?
That's something, yeah.
Wow.
So it's just Batman. Like 2.5 hours of just the Dark Knight wandering the streets, looking brutally. Is that a word? Brutally? Broody? Brutal?
Brooding?
Like somber. Brooding.
To do something brutally? Broodingly?
Broodingly. Broodingly is, I think, the word.
Oh, sorry. I didn't want to interrupt. But, so.
Yeah. So I didn't stop talking you now. At your request. Please continue.
All right. Let's move things along. One thing I want to mention real quick before we go on. We have launched our first Kickstarter. We need your help to get to PAX Prime. You can go to tinyurl.com/MMOReporterPAX and check out our Kickstarter campaign. I will throw it in the chat room right now for anybody who's there. Please go check it out. We've got some pretty cool backer rewards there, including getting to send us some questions to ask devs, some swag from PAX, and if you're local from Seattle, even the opportunity to have dinner with some of the MMO Reporter crew. So if that sounds...
I must say that the stretch goal for $2,000, you didn't discuss that with me, but I'm willing to do whatever you told them I would do for that amount of money.
Harry, that's not safe for work here. We can't talk about that publicly. That's going to be like a high money to backers.
I will paint that house. I will paint that house.
Okay, this is getting weird.
Especially considering how hot it is.
Yeah, that is a lot of work.
How hot is it?
Anyways, so go check it out. And please consider backing. If everyone who listens to the podcast just donated $1, we would very much exceed our funding goal. In fact, in just the 2 days that we've started here, we started yesterday early, we have hit 14% of our goal. So I'm incredibly proud of that. Really excited moving forward. We do have some stretch goals in mind. We're not going to talk about that yet. But please go check it out. tinyurl.com/MMOReporterPAX.
People play way too many hours. We do each and every.
So I know Harry really didn't want to talk about Elder Scrolls Online, so I'm going to respect your wishes, Harry, and we're going to talk a little bit about Elder Scrolls Online.
Thank you.
I'm here to help. So ESO has actually been doing remarkably well on PlayStation 4. I came across kind of the sales numbers that have been popping up in the PlayStation store, and it is just going gangbuster. It's the top selling game on the PlayStation store in June. It was the top selling game in the launch week in the UK on the PlayStation store. Even the subscription, like the Elite or the upgrade for ESO is the top selling add-on in the PlayStation store. So, and this is not a free to play bump or anything like that. The game is still $70 Canadian and whatever it is in other, I think it's probably $60 US and all that kind of thing. So it's not cheap. It's so that it's not getting a boost that way. So what's going on for all you PS4 people that are on the podcast, is ESO just that much better on the console? Is that where this game was really is that does that work? Is it does it fit better there than as a PC launch?
Harry, well, you take this one.
I'm hearing myself in an echo.
I haven't changed anything.
Okay. Never mind. I have actually, there are some changes, some fundamental changes to the PC version. The first of which, the main one, is obviously the lack of subscription and making the game fully buy to play, which is a much better fit for a console. People are very much willing to pay 60, 70 bucks for a full game, especially if they are not forced to shell out another 15 bucks a month to actually access it. So that helps. I also think what my theory is that most people who are buying this game are not buying it for the MMO thing, but want another Elder Scrolls game. And if you squint and you ignore other people, you can kind of play it like a Skyrim Lite. And it is a solid production. I mean, they fixed a lot of the nagging bits of the first PC launch, so it's not entirely without merit. I can't fathom why people are so flocking to this. I don't really get it. There are I'm writing a review, and one of the points I'm making in the article that's not yet published, so this is all very secretive. But if you would want the best possible role playing experience on your PlayStation 4, you would go for The Witcher 3, for example. And if you want an actual fun MMO experience, you're out of luck because Elder Scrolls Online doesn't provide that either. So it's
well, but you know what? I think Final Fantasy 14 is a solid MMO experience on console.
True. That is. But that's even closer to an actual WoW style MMO if you're into that than Elder Scrolls Online. But neither of the aspects of the game are best in class, and I would say fine in the F word meaning, as Bill put it.
Yeah, the thing about ESO is it's okay. There's nothing wrong with it.
And the thing is, it's not even beating. It's not like it's got no competition out there. Like the number two selling game was Arkham Knight, which is a huge title that's just come out. Witcher 3 is right behind in there. Final Fantasy 14 is way down the list at number 19. To be fair, it's also been out for long has it been? PS4. It wasn't a launch title, but it's been around for.
It was a launch title because it was playable on the PlayStation 3 already.
Right.
Oh, was it? Pardon me.
Yeah.
But in any case, so I mean, it's not like it's actually successful, and I think the big issue I'm having here is my brain is tuned to have Elder Scrolls just be this very meh experience, which everyone else seems to be describing it as, The numbers don't bear that out, or at least the recent numbers. So,
well, I know when I first got into Elder Scrolls in the first place was because it felt like it was an online game. It was a huge world that I could just wander around, do quests and stuff like that, and just have a role-playing game experience. And the way that I ended up playing the games later on, you know, like Oblivion and Skyrim and stuff, I've always, and I'm going to get flack from you guys for this, I've always felt like the Elder Scroll games are always more popular on consoles than they were on computer.
I don't know. The modding community for Skyrim is still vibrant. I mean, if there is one community that's still supporting and playing the game, it's the PC folks. I do think, I don't know if that translates to more copies sold, but I do think there are more hardcore Elder Scrolls fans on the PC than on the console.
And wasn't only Skyrim available on last gen stuff and nothing before, not the huge library of Elder Scrolls games?
Well, Morrowind was out on the first Xbox, and
was
I played,
it?
Yeah.
Was Oblivion?
A ton of that. Oblivion was on the 360.
Okay, there you go. So it has been around for a while. But no, I agree with Harry on that. My wonder now is, though, are people just trying it out because it's available on there, like Bill was saying? Like, now that the games have sold, right, are we going to see this again in July, I think, is the big thing. Is it going to continue to be? are they ever going to release concurrent number of players? Are they ever going to release, you know, they're a private company, aren't they? Because it's ZeniMax owned by Bethesda. Is Bethesda public? Do they have to release sales numbers?
I don't know.
Right? I wonder if this is the, ooh, look, shiny new thing. It's Elder Scrolls-y. Let's go buy it.
Well, right? I mean, it's not like I need to insult everybody who is playing and enjoying the game. I mean, everybody's entitled to enjoy. I'm not even going to make a glib remark about that. I mean, if you're into this, great. I personally don't get it, and I just see this as another bit of proof that reviews don't matter as much as people say they do, because the game has not gotten a glowing review from anybody.
No, and I think the biggest thing that we hear is it's okay. Like, that's what... Mm-hmm. There's nothing there, but I look at the community, I look at the subreddit, I look at the community sites that are out there, and there's a strong community for this game. There's a lot of people chatting about it, right?
And maybe it's that we're just... I mean, we've been playing MMOs for a long time, and I can imagine people who have not done all MMOs ever and have a console and now are just getting into this experience of having this persistent huge world. Yeah. And if you look at it as your first MMO, I don't know, maybe then it is mind-blowingly fantastic. I don't know. I can't look at it with those innocent eyes anymore, because I know Guild Wars 2 is a lot better. I know Final Fantasy 14 is a lot better. So I know there are better games out there. So I don't know. I'm just, maybe it's good. This big influx of new money will help them improve the game even more, because they have not stood. They have improved it.
Yeah,
done a lot of work on it.
Couple things. I wonder if consoles are going through that MMO boom that we had, and a whole bunch of console players are now getting into the whole MMO experience that, you know, hit big on PCs 10 years ago. And Wings of Faith in the chat room is also mentioning that he thinks it comes down to that he can just buy the game, get his friends to buy it, and that's it. They just play.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Which is every free-to-play game now, right? MMOs are just like that now, other than a few holdouts, right? Final Fantasy 14, WoW, right? Just a few other... doesn't Ultima Online still have a subscription?
Yes.
Right? So, stuff like that.
The big one, yeah.
Yeah, the big one.
EverQuest 2.
No, EverQuest is free to play.
Yeah, EverQuest 2 is free to play.
No, EverQuest.
EverQuest is free to play as well,
but they've got the station pass that, yeah,
oh,
you can get
me.
Stuff. It's limited.
But the final thing is, I mean, the one thing I do like about this development is that this is a huge boost for the principle of buy to play. And I really want to see more of that. I think that is a much better path to choose than a full-on free-to-play title or a full-on subscription. This is my favorite way of playing a game. Buying the game and then just not worry about it until the expansion comes out.
Right. All right, let's move things along. We've been talking a lot about Final Fantasy 14 in our ESO discussion. We do have some news here in a post by producer and director Naoki Yoshida on the Final Fantasy 14 website that the Final Fantasy 14 OS X version is no longer for sale, and they will be issuing refunds to some customers. This is kind of a big deal. They had huge issues with the Mac version, mostly coming down to the way in which they ported it. They used a technology called Cider. It's a Mac port technology that saves on development costs. They knew that there weren't going to be very many people playing Final Fantasy 14 on OS X, but they wanted to offer it, so they went with this cheap way of doing it and a very small team. They were not able to get the game to a point where they were happy releasing it, and I think this again speaks to Square Enix's focus on having a quality product. They pulled Final Fantasy 14, completely rebuilt the game, and then put it out again. Obviously they want quality, so this isn't surprising. But
why not do a good job in one? I mean, they, if they are really raking in the money with Final Fantasy XIV. It's the one reason Square Enix is just is still very profitable. It's there. It is a cash cow in the same, almost on the same scale as World of Warcraft. It's the number one MMO in Japan, and Japan is not a small country. A lot of people playing this game. So why not? If you're gonna do this, do it right. Isn't that a song?
Well, I think it was. I think it was a risk to reward ratio sort of thing, right? They weren't going to have a lot of people playing it, and they did get to the point where if they weren't going to do it right, why do it at all? And they said, okay, we're not going to do it at all. They might look at some different stuff. They couldn't get it to where they wanted to. 2020 hindsight, though, right? They probably thought going to this, yeah, we can do it. We can make a good product.
No, but they're talking about Macs. I mean, if there is one platform that's almost console-like in this homogeneity, they're all the same, those Macs.
Well, but that's part of the problem. They actually said that the difference between a higher-end Mac and a low-end Mac was not, you couldn't program it with the same flexibility that you could PCs, apparently, according to this post and some other things that I read as well. It just wasn't that simple. You'd think that, but that was one of the problems they had, was that spectrum between the low end and the high end.
But that's not the point. The point is that they could test it on all iterations of the OS. They have a lot. No, never mind. Bill, make your point.
I was just going to say, maybe this is less of an indictment of Square Final Fantasy XIV and more of an indictment of OS X as far as gaming is concerned. I mean, this is not an uncommon theme on OS X is the struggle to put out games on that platform.
Yeah,
and it's not like OS X is it's certainly not like the tiny niche that it was 10 years ago. Like it's a pretty significant base right now. So it's not a matter of, is there enough people or is there enough Macs out there to make it worthwhile? It's starting to become a question. Is OS X a viable gaming platform?
Well,
can it ever be?
And I'll throw this link here in the show notes. They've with the newest version of OS X, El Capitan.
Please, killing me, Chris.
Yeah, it's OS X.
OS X.
OS X is a porn.
Cool.
There's OS X.
How do you know? Anyways,
You're 34.
Anyways, there's some new tech in El Capitan, the newest update for OS X. I did that on purpose. I'm sorry, OS X. I think it's called Metal. That is the way in which the graphic card works with the OS to draw things faster, and apparently is doing very, very well for gaming. So they are making a push for it. It's just not quite there yet.
I still think it's easy to blame Apple for this when they had internal tests, they had beta tests, they had all kinds of points. No, they had all kinds of moments where they saw this is not an optimal experience, and they could have tested it on, they could have gone out and bought a couple of Macs in different ranges, see how it ran, and say, oh, wait, this is not working, let's not do it. This is weird.
Yeah.
I don't get it.
Yeah, but as we saw with the original launch of Final Fantasy XIV, Square Enix doesn't like to hold off on the launching. They just like to rescind their launches sometimes. Funny note.
There's a dirty joke in there somewhere. But
funny note. I Googled to try and find out a few other things about this, and the first 1.5 pages of my search results were all the exact same headline. Exactly.
Optimization for the win.
Yeah. Exactly the same headline. It's just, oh wow, everybody just pulled from the press release. Okay. All right, let's move on. Our sponsors, Audible. Go to audiblepodcast.com/MMOReporter. And you can get a free month of the Audible service, which means you get one free audiobook. You sign up for a subscription, you get a monthly credit as part of that, and you get to get that Audible book. They've now changed it. If you ever tried Audible years and years ago, it used to be some books were 2 credits, some books were 3. Every book is a credit now. So every month you can get a new book, no matter what the length. And Doghouse Systems. Use the coupon code MMOReporter for a free 120 gig solid state drive with your purchase. If you're looking for a new computer, go check out our friends at Doghouse Systems. I know Carrie loves her Doghouse Systems. So let's move things along.
So I ask, please don't delete my guy after beta. Please don't crush that part of my soul. Please don't delete my guy after beta. Please, my guy makes me feel whole. Please don't delete my guy after beta.
It's Raider Z or Raiders.
I did a couple of interviews with them at PAX, actually.
Oh,
times.
Did you?
I did, yeah.
I didn't even know that. It is a MMO that kind of was like Monster Hunter, the Nintendo Monster Hunter games. And it was out for Perfect World for a while, and then Arc Games picked it up. So there was two companies, two publishers that had this game. And then Perfect World ended up closing their servers, I think within less than a year. And Arc Games kept it going. Well, Arc Games is now closing that game. And the main reason why is because the company that was helping them fix the game and keep things running is closed now. So they're going to be closing the game down. It's going to be closing on August 7th. If anybody still has any subscriptions or anything like that, they're going to be refunding those extra months past August 7th. And they're kind of doing like a little festival thing inside of the game right now. So if you are playing the game or haven't played the game in a while, jump on now.
Yeah, now, quick correction there. Sorry. Arc Games is actually the Perfect World sort of ecosystem that they've done now. So that is actually the same thing, Perfect World. The company was Myatt that was developing Raiders that has shut down.
Right. I think there were two companies that had it, though. I think it was Perfect World and this one, too. You know, they're part of the same thing. But I think the servers were closed down in Japan first.
Okay.
And then the Western servers were still up, which are these.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I know something was going on. I just didn't remember exactly what it was.
Yeah, that's too bad. Raiders was like Monster Hunter MMO, was really what it was.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of a shame, though, because, like, apparently it was doing all right.
Yeah, it's too bad that the developer shut down. All right, then. On that great discussion, Harry, you had something that you brought to the show.
Oh, yeah, there's another game closing down. Lane was talking about a game, so it dies. I mean, what's new?
Didn't you play Raiders? Didn't you cover Raiders when it came out, Lanor?
That was one of the first reviews that I did, yes.
Yeah. So that's
about time it died, I guess.
It's lasted longer than any other game.
Yep, it held out as a little trooper.
Yeah.
Lanor's finger of death. What game will it point at next? Okay. Quick mention of a Notch, the creator of Minecraft, was kind of outspoken on Twitter in a discussion with Duke Nukem 3D developer George Broussard. They got into kind of a Twitter fitty. Notch calls free-to-play bait and switch and should be illegal. And to just expand on this a little bit, the discussion started with Mr. Broussard, who is one of the guys who created Duke Nukem 3D, not to be confused with Duke Nukem Forever, which was horrible. 3D was the actual good one. He on Twitter said, at some point, game developers who are elitist and anti-free-to-play games will have to get over themselves. To which Marcus Persson, also known as Notch, responded, okay, I'm not going to use the expletive. F that noise. Free-to-play is bait and switch and should be illegal. And then the conversation descended quickly into other types of name-calling. But basically, my question to you guys of the MMO Reporter panel is there some truth in that? Is free-to-play actually just basically unethical, or is it a trick played on people?
Well, is your question, is there some truth, or is this the truth?
Is there some truth in that, yes.
Bill, why don't you start that one?
I was just because I'm building momentum here.
Hot potato, throw it over there.
At its core, it's not. In the same way that communism is not necessarily a bad idea if you just look at the principle. Practical application.
Way to scale it down. Way to keep the discussion focused.
Hey, I at least haven't brought Nazis into it yet.
Yeah.
That said, for practical application, though, it kind of is. Like, I don't know that I've seen a real free-to-play implementation that isn't a degraded experience over what it's kind of billed as. It lends itself very much to saying, here, try this out. You don't need anything else. It's free. Free is right in the title. Oh, wait, here, buy this, do this. You can't really do that unless you buy this. Pay this, pay the subscription to this so you don't have to deal with buying things all over the place. Oh, but even though you are subscribed, keep buying stuff because we like your money. The practical application of it is scummy. And it's the way it works out. And I have a feeling a lot of people, when they enter into that model, they don't intend to be scummy, but it just winds up going there.
I prefer the free-to-play model over buying to play and then finding out there's a huge cash shop of stuff that I have to pay for afterwards.
Well, that's for sure. So you find out before you buy or make a pre-order, right, Chris?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What, pre-order what? Sorry, you want me to pre-order what?
Put that wallet away.
That's credit card, yeah.
Oh. Darn it, I was trying to throw my credit card at the screen and nothing was happening.
Take my money, damn it. I don't know what you're selling, but I want it. Yeah. Which is basically what pre-ordering is.
Yep.
I hate this money. Get it out of my wallet. Ick, ick, ick.
Okay, it depends on the way you look at it, I think. I mean, a lot of quote-unquote free games on iOS are actually just tricking you into buying games for way too much money. But I think MMOs could be seen in a way as kind of a platform for fun. And by getting into the platform for free and then buying your way through the actual content, I don't think there's anything wrong with that if it's done correctly. I mean, I think Lord of the Rings Online still had a great system. I think Dungeons and Dragons Online did it very well, being able to buy a piece of content and enjoy it as much as you want for an unlimited amount of time. Mm-hmm. Don't think there's anything bait and switchy about that because you know what you're getting into.
Yeah.
I mean, is Windows 10 bait and switch? Because you still need to buy Office to be able to use any, to do anything on it.
Oh, I haven't bought Office for 10 years. It's not like I've been stealing it either. I just don't use it. But that's a whole other discussion. I think where I was going to go is I think the complexity of an MMO, there's so many different things going on there that it is a little bit disingenuous because to be able to be charging for those pieces and as you're moving along in the game or as you progress through the game and if you want to experience new bits of content, because there's so many bits of content, there's so many sub games built into it. It's not like you're just buying a new map because there's crafting, there's socialization, there's dungeons, there's so much under the hood that's there and practically winds up being exploited and microtransacted. And I think there's going to be a lot of fatigue for people having to deal with those kind of microtransactions. I think for a while people were quite keen on it. The while the market was still feeling itself out in terms of free to play, I think there was a lot of consumer friendliness to it to try to keep people from having a really extreme reaction to it. But now that it's kind of shaking itself out, I think people are going to get tired of it. They're going to have maybe five or six games in their stable, and each game is going to want you to drop a dollar here, $2 here, and people mm-hmm. are. It's not even going to be so much the amount of money you're spending on the game; it's the complexity of having to deal with what you're spending over all your games.
But compare this to Call of Duty, which I think is actually genuinely bait and switch, because you buy the game for $60. And if you are really into that game, they reward you by forcing you to pay for map packs, because otherwise you'll have to just stop playing, because your friends are going to be doing the new maps and everybody else is left behind. And I think that's way more unkind than asking me for a little XP boost somewhere, or again, talking about MMOs here, not talking about Candy Crush, which is evil and should be killed and burned with fire.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
As opposed to burned with water.
It's not at the top of the evil ladder, but it's certainly on the ladder, I think. Free-to-play is on that scale.
By the way, just a general announcement. No, I do not want to buy Candy Crush. Just a general thing. People keep sending me Candy Crush invites on Facebook. No, I do not want to buy or play or do any crushing of candy of any kind.
I'm sorry, Harry.
I'll crush your skull.
Sorry, Harry.
Did you ever read the legal schmozzle over Candy Crush, about how the company that owns Candy Crush tried to kill the guy, or not kill the guy, but kill the business of the guy who made...
Yeah.
Anyway.
The Viking Saga thing, which was actually a game about an actual saga, and Candy Crush King actually claimed the word saga as their own, which was an interesting claim for a game about candy! Sorry.
Are you okay?
Yes, we talked about that.
All right, I think...
I hate Candy Crush so much. I hate it so much.
I think it's time to
move
things along.
It's such an ugly game. It makes me physically sick when I actually look at the screen.
Harry?
Calm the F down. Aw, like an old friend coming back after a long time. And his ugly sister. Yeah.
Yes, dear.
Anyways, moving things along, quick mentions. As Bill mentioned earlier, Guild Wars 2 has been data mined. There is going to be a desert borderland. You can check out a story on 10 Ton Hammer about that. Bill, as our Guild Wars 2 expert, what do you think?
It's an interesting map. If it's laid out the way I think it appears to be laid out, it does look like it lends itself a little bit more to pinch points. So you could hopefully, maybe that leads to it being a little bit more strategic. I don't know. It looks like a huge map, just between the transitions of the different land types and everything like that. So hard to say when you're just looking at the map, but I'm hopeful and optimistic. How about that?
Love to hear what all our Guild Wars 2 players out there think about this. Crowfall, pre-alpha combat testing is starting at the end of the summer. This is going to be session-based, team-focused PvP games, not the full game, just testing combat. They're going to start with pre-alpha testers at the end of the summer, then move on to the Alpha 1 group, drawing people in as the system allows and as necessary in order to get the data that they need. I'm kind of excited about this. I'm not pre-alpha or alpha 1. So...
What is Crowfall again? Could you do a quick explanation of the principle again?
Crowfall is... take Shadowbane, which was persistent world, PvP, always PvP, and trying to own the world, and take away that persistence of the world itself and build it instead into campaigns of predetermined lengths with different rules. So it could be a campaign of a week, could be a campaign of a month, could be a campaign of a year, but it's going to reset at some point, so you know that you're not going to have entrenched positions forever for people who've been playing for a long time. Then there's the Eternal Kingdoms is like your permanent housing development slash lobby. Very interesting in that there's going to be these different campaigns and different rules. And, you know, some are going to be realm versus realm versus realm. Some of them are going to be two factions. Some of them are going to be guild versus guild. All sorts of different stuff. They have a lot of flexibility in there.
Sounds awesome.
It does. It sounds fantastic. And that's one of the reasons Bill and I were jumping into Guild Wars 2, because that's sort of the closest analog we could think of in World versus World and the SPVP as well to what that's going to be that's out there right now, that sort of persistence. So we're very excited about that. So if anybody did pay the exorbitant amount of money to get into that pre-alpha or alpha 1, congratulations. You're probably going to test this summer. Woohoo. Yay.
I'm going to keep an eye on this. Thanks for mentioning it. Sounds like a very
listen to Crowfall Reporter. Yeah. You'll find out more about the game. And just a couple of follow-up stories that we're just going to throw in here about some discussions from wonderful luminaries of gaming credentials like Derek Smart. Following up on our discussion last week about Star Citizen and its incredibly valued luxury ship, right, Harry? Wait, no, don't start. We don't have enough time left.
I just calmed down from Candy Crush, and now you're going to talk about...
We've got a whole collection of stories there for you to take a look at that we thought were interesting, sort of following up on this whole idea, talking about feature creep into the game, whether or not that's happening, which Star Citizen said, no, we're spending your $81 million lightly.
It's not feature creep. We're building everything that ever existed and billions of stars. What do you mean feature creep?
Yeah, exactly.
So basically in the last week, Derek Smart kind of vocalized what a lot of people were sort of thinking about Star Citizen, that the idea of Star Citizen is bigger than could possibly be developed. Now, a lot of people are questioning whether Derek Smart should even be telling other people to make games until he gets it figured out for himself. But I don't know. There's a kernel of truthiness to that, I think, in that... Yeah, it's not done, and it's not close to done. And
Derek Smart. Oh, sorry, I thought you were done.
Oh no, Derek. No. It's not done, and it appears to be going slowly. It doesn't seem to be screaming out. Yes.
That's the Smart theme for anybody who's wondering.
So, do you think? Is it viable to be concerned about how long it's taking for Star Citizen to fulfill its vision?
I don't think it's completely... I mean, the first time I heard the mention of Derek Smart criticizing Star Citizen of being overambitious, I laughed, obviously, because that is kind of the joke in itself. For those who don't know, Derek Smart was at the helm of Battlecruiser 3000 AD, which was a space simulator that was supposed to simulate everything, just like a very similar pitch, actually, as Star Citizen. And it failed because the game was overly ambitious and was very buggy and didn't deliver everything as promised.
And Derek Smart did everything himself. He was a one-man development team.
Exactly. And I think if anybody's in a position to at least appreciate the chunk of challenge they've bitten themselves off. Is that a good... mixing my metaphors again. Anyway, they've bitten something. But Derek Smart knows what it takes to fail at building a huge space sim. So I don't think it's... I don't think it's completely honest to just dismiss his opinion as, well, you failed. Well, yeah, he knows how and why these games go tits up. So that's a bridge expression. It's Star Citizen. It's the company that promised a game and is selling ships that don't fly.
No, they do fly, but they don't fight.
They don't fly because there's no game. And if there's no game, they don't fly.
Oh, okay. I get it.
But they'll fly someday.
At a point.
You're not even... It's not even just pre-ordering the game. You're pre-ordering this ship.
Yeah, you're pre-ordering the ship for the game that doesn't exist.
Because ship will ever be available when the game is actually out.
Imagine, if you will, Call of Duty, and you're pre-ordering the soldier. This is what they're doing.
The rocket launcher.
We're done. Moving along. We have talked about this enough. Bill, if people want to contact us, how would they do that?
Well, they can go to MMOReporter.com. Hey, Harry, we've got a website. Did you know?
I did not. Tell me about it.
Oh, well, you can find it at MMOReporter.com, and it is the central hub of the entire MMO Reporter network, linking over to all of our brother and sister podcasts, and just generally being a great hub for everything MMO Reportery. You can send us an email to mmo.reporter@gmail.com. You can find us on Facebook, facebook.com/mmoreporter. You can tweet at any of the MMO reporters, either at MMO_reporter for Chris, at Harry Hall for Harry Hall, at Leonor for Leonor, and at MMO Bill for yours truly. You can give us a call at 616-666-6778. Leave us a voicemail. Let us know what you think about Star Citizen or Candy Crush or whatever you like. And we'll if it's, if it's comprehensible, we'll put it on the show. You can find a few of us over at Zerg ID. Chris is known as Almazar there. Leonor is Leonor. The deprecated Woe account is still there, but it's just that deprecated. You can find us over on YouTube, youtube.com/MMOReporterNetwork. Of course, you can find us on Patreon, as we've mentioned earlier, patreon.com/MMOReporter. And you can also head over to the MMOReporter.com website. And I believe it's MMOReporter.com/support to figure out all kinds of money-ish ways that you can support MMO Reporter in our ventures in life. But I mean, there's a specific venture that you're actually shooting for, isn't there, Chris?
There is. Our Kickstarter, tinyurl.com/MMOReporterPacks. Please go check it out. If, like I mentioned earlier, if we just got a little bit of support from everyone who downloads the podcast, even a dollar, we would easily hit our goals. So please go check it out. tinyurl.com/MMOReporterPacks. We want to go to PAX Prime. We want to get all those videos where I find out about Guild of Dungeoneering, where I found out a bit about the repopulation, where I got to play and show and share the experience with Harry and our listeners and viewers about trying out Elite Dangerous on an Oculus Rift. All that sort of stuff. We want to recreate PAX for you. So go check it out, please. Again, tinyurl.com/MMOReporterPacks. We would very, very much appreciate it. Bill, a fantastic show, as always.
Well, thank you. I agree. It's fantastic.
And Leonor, as always, there was no pant-like impediment to your podcasting this week.
Yeah, I know. But I have to say, Harry, I missed you. Give me a hug, man. Come here. Come here, give me a hug.
Okay, that's long enough. Let go, Leonor. Please let go.
Don't touch me there. You touch me there.
Harry,
that was a good touch.
As always, a pleasure to have you on the show.
A dollar, you said, but that's a quarter of an actual Starbucks coffee. Price.
You can back more. Thank
I need
you.
To save my dollars for my coffee.
No.
Okay. I'll drink less
Thank
coffee
you.
Just for
Thank
you.
Thank you. You should back us. All right. Thanks, everyone, for listening to the podcast, watching the podcast on YouTube, or however you find the show. We sure appreciate it. We hope that you download again next week. I also want to thank everyone who's in the chat room today. We had a nice, fun chat room and everybody hanging out. Thanks, everyone, for listening. We hope that you listen again next week, but most importantly, we hope to see you in game. And hopefully it backs.
Don't forget about your alts. You need to cherish each and every little character you've got, no matter what level they're at. Don't forget about your alts. You need to cherish.
Thanks for watching the video, everybody. Don't forget to check out all the other podcasts at mmoreporter.com or by clicking on any of the links here. And please check out our Patreon campaign at patreon.com/mmoreporter. Thanks, everyone, and see you in game.